Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm very, very happy and honored to be in this very, very distinguished milieu of people, of professionals and professors and academic professors. And I have to tell you in advance that officials that, I mean, Greek statistics and economic growth was not my responsibility, you know, the title was not my proper responsibility, so I changed it a little bit, you know, to official statistics and economic growth. Although I say a couple of words in the, towards the, at the end of my presentation about rebranding Greek statistics and the whole effort that we're delving into. So what you, some of you already know, but you know, I just want to make clear, you know, is that Hellenic Statistical Authority, we call it Hellenic, you know, Elstat, is the National Statistical Service of Greece. It is situated in Piraeus, and which is like a separate city, is the port of Athens, historically. And there's a brand new, I mean, only 15 years old building that, in which we are, we're hosted. Now, the Hellenic Statistical Authority is the coordinator of the so-called Hellenic Statistical System. So the Hellenic Statistical System is the group of agencies and authorities, as we call it, that produce official statistics in Greece. Okay, the Hellenic Statistical Authority has the rare privilege of being the coordination authority of all those guys that produce official statistics, including ministries and some other authorities. We have a distinction of agencies and authorities, meaning that agencies are ministries, for example, that produce statistics for their own sake, but authorities are the agencies, I mean, including some of the ministries that produce European statistics. So meaning statistics that are regulated by European regulations. So that's a very, very fundamental distinction. I have this nice scheme here, and I'm probably gonna, this is gonna be the last one, where I have the Hellenic Statistical System over here, meaning that, you know, Elstat is the coordinator of national authorities plus agencies. And then I have like a, I mean, self-similar type of thing, you know, over here, which is like in the European statistical system, where the role of the coordinator is played by Eurostat. Okay, this has to do with the European statistical system, and since the governor of the Bank of Greece is here, you know, I should not miss, you know, mentioning the fact that there is a separate pillar of production of European statistics in the European Union, which is the European system of central banks. They have their own, let me say, hierarchy. And in the past, there have been, you know, some issues, you know, between, you know, for sorting out, you know, some matters that turned out to be like theological rather than statistical. Okay, but right now we're in a very good, in very good terms. Okay, the Bank of Greece, in particular, is responsible in our case for compiling the financial accounts of the general government, meaning like one of the nine tables that go to Eurostat, describing what is the fiscal balance of Greece, and also for compiling the balance of payment statistics. Okay, we feed them with one part of the balance of payments, meaning like the balance of goods, and then they return to us the block of the balance of payments, and then we use it in our GDP. I mean, as a block to our GDP calculations. The mission is to safeguard and continuously improve the development, production, and dissemination and communication of official statistics in Greece. So, thus, Elstat is and remains independent. Of course, this does not follow from the other thing, but it is, it remains, it is an independent authority, meaning that it is independent in administrative terms since 2010, okay? So for those last 9 years, Elstat is an independent authority. When we say independence, talking about statistics, we don't mean administrative independence only. Administrative independence is neither a necessary nor a sufficient condition for professional independence. In some European member states, for example, for I take an example of INSEE in France, it's just a directorate of the Ministry of Finance. That doesn't mean that it is not professionally independent. Huh? Professional independence has to do with whether statisticians succumb to temptations to accepting orders by their political masters. Okay. In our case, we don't have, we're not supervised by any ministry, okay? And it is the only independent authority, administratively independent authority in Greece, that is not supervised by any ministry. That doesn't mean, of course, that we're not accountable to someone, huh? We're accountable as regards the execution of our budget, of our budget to the parliament, but not as regards the compilation of our statistics. Nobody has the right to ask us, well, they have the right. Sometimes they ask us, they pose questions, you know, during the hearings that I have in the parliament. And, you know, I feel happy, I have no problem to answer to those questions. Still, I'm solely responsible about the production, I mean, myself and my associates, about the production of statistics. And in that matter, whether I'm going to decide, for example, for a classification of an agency to the registry of, entities that belong to the public sector, for example, I mean, in statistical terms, I'm not, it is my sole decision, okay? I don't hear anyone, and I don't have any of, hierarchical relation with anyone else, you know, be it in the government or anyone else, anywhere else in the Greek administration. So we cover pretty much, you know, everything, all fields of activity of the public and private sector. This includes environment, primary sector statistics, includes, of course, national accounts, fiscal statistics, GDP, structural business statistics, and everything that could be related to LFS, labor force survey, living condition statistics. And I'm just mentioning this because here in the US there are probably, you know, two or three different entities. I mean, there's a Census Bureau dealing with population counting. I mean, we do that at home. We have the Bureau of Labor Statistics, I mean, which is a separate entity. I mean, these are the those bureaus are subject to the, I mean, fundamental principles of official statistics that has outlined in the United Nations, as we are too. But I just want to stress the fact that we're in charge of producing all those statistics in Greece. And this is actually our holy Bible. This is the code of practice for the European Statistics Code of Practice. It's an implementation of the, it's a specification, let me put it like that, to the idiosyncrasies of the European statistical system. I mean, to the fact that we have European regulations that tell us on how to compile European statistics. I mean, statistics that are important in the way that European policies or EU policies are designed. For example, EDP statistics. Huh? Again, I'm just saying that because this European Statistics Code of Practice comes with a quality assurance framework. And again, this is our way of assessing whether, and this is how we are assessed by our peers, because the European statistical system is a peer-regulated system. So we have a coordinator, which is Eurostat, but this holds only as regards European statistics, I mean, statistics that are regulated by a European regulation. And, but other than that, we're considered equal. Now, going back to this European statistics, I'm going to isolate those three principles over here, because those three principles over here are the ones that underline what we call professional independence. Okay, this is professional independence is number one, meaning like, okay, we don't require professional independence only for ourselves, but you also require professional independence as regards the compilation of statistics of agencies in the Hellenic statistical system. Okay, I'll come to that later. Another important thing, I mean, that would be a reason for one to lose their job. As you know, our associates are civil servants and they cannot be fired or, or even hired in another way we would like, but they cannot be fired. But I can tell you that, you know, there is one reason, that the breach of statistical confidentiality and data protection, meaning the unveiling the identity of a person, okay, or an enterprise, okay? And this comes back to where other colleagues, you know, talked about, you know, competition experts, you know, can be very, very crucial not to, just to protect the data of companies because of competition concerns. So statistical confidentiality is extremely important for us. If we just breach that, if we just go away, we will not be able to do our job anymore. I mean, the tax office can always collect taxes, you know, after breaching anything that has to do with confidentiality of, you know, individual data. But we cannot, because the output, I mean, our output is not monetary, it's not pecuniary. Our output is, has to do with, I mean, it is, our output is basically information. We're just a machine that we have input as data, and then we produce information. And the quality of information deteriorates, okay? And deteriorates as a direct function of the, you know, I mean, as an inverse function of the trust, you know, that users, you know, bear in us. Okay, the other issue now have to do with impartiality and objectivity. And indicator 6.7 has to do with equal access of all users to statistical information. This is extremely crucial. I mean, it's very important for you guys to know that in Greece and in most, and I put an asterisk over there, EU countries, the prime minister learns at the same time, you know, flagship data about GDP, about fiscal balance, and about pretty much everything. About everything, period, not pretty much everything. It is extremely important for you to know. So we don't grant privileged or pre-release access to the Minister of Finance or to the Prime Minister or any other user. I mean, it's obvious the reason why we don't do that, like, because, I mean, some of that data, you know, are market sensitive. And in case we were about to grant pre-release access to someone, as it is done in the UK, for example, they have, I think, a 24-hour window in which they allow for for example, policymakers to know about that. I don't know, it's the governor of the Bank of England, is the Prime Minister and the Minister of Finance. There might be reasons, you know, that in that particular country they have thought that it is important to do so. I mean, users know that those guys, they know in advance that those guys have access to that particular data at that particular time window. Now you know that, I know that the data, my Director of National Accounts knows that too, and the Director General of Statistics knows that too. And the people actually who compile, you know, that data, but you know that and you can see what we're doing with that. Now, I'll come to the my favorite part of the discussion, you know, here. I'm not gonna say, I mean, you don't expect from me to say that perception is reality. No, it's not reality. It's not always reality. But what is important for us is to be, not only to be reliable and good, but also to be perceived as such. Because trust stems exactly from that, you know, from the way that we are perceived. I mean, I can always, and you know, independence is not something that I can be, I can be self-proclaimed as independent. Huh? This is not something you observe. This is not something that I just, you know, answer in a questionnaire, as we do. We work through with other agencies. You know, we form partnerships. We try to cooperate with universities. I sincerely hope that, you know, some researchers, you know, here are going to help us in the future with things that they know. But it is our strategic priority. It is my strategic priority to create partnerships, because we cannot do, and we don't know how to do everything. Okay, we want people to use our data. We want people to corroborate the validity of our data. We want people to be confident that our data are okay and can be used for research purposes. Coordination is an issue that I explained, you know, before, when I talk about the form of the format of the Hellenic statistical system and the European statistical system. We have a coordinating role, of course, in the the Hellenic statistical system. But what is the most important here, I want to stress, is that methods are not everything in official statistics. The most important thing is to make sure that we measure the same thing with the same way. And when it comes to European statistics, okay, we know that we apply the same regulation, and we somehow know that we're going to, you know, have pretty much, I'm going to use this, you know, the same standards. And I've used the word pretty much because sometimes, you know, it's a result of a negotiation between, a political negotiation in European bodies, decision-making bodies, I mean, even the statistical regulation. But what is the most important is to have coordination in a worldwide level, eh? To be sure that the fiscal balance, for example, in the US is measured in the same way that it is measured in Greece. Comparability, this also ensures comparability, you know, it's the most important thing. The reason why I mentioned, I think. And then it ends up, you know, to what we call, you know, overall, you know, credibility and reliability. Now, having said that, there are threats. I mean, threats can be in several, can come in several forms. I mean, one particular type of threat I can think about that is accidents. You heard about accidents in the past, you know, but at least two speakers, and I also tried to make a question on this. We may have an accident. Question is whether we learn from accidents or not. Question is whether we can fall and we can get up again, and we can just show that we're more, you know, resilient in that way. But all in all is that I believe that, I'll come to that later. I believe that, you know, accidents can help us, and sometimes the only way to foster, you know, credibility in the public is an accident. Huh? Now, populism is a very, very typical example of a risk. And the very, very first casualty of populism is official statistics, because populism targets facts and the traceability of facts. Okay, these are the two important things that populism targets. And then, sometimes when you are a chief statistician and you don't face any of those challenges, you probably have to think about whether you're irrelevant or not. Okay, so meaning that if nobody cares about you, if you don't feel any threat, and you know, threats, you know, nowadays do not come only, you know, through a phone call from a minister, for example, of finance, okay, and or asking for a, you know, a pre-release or anything. You know, threats are, you know, leaks in newspapers and you know, things like that. You know, easy things. Huh? So that's why we have decided to be transparent. So we invite you to come to our premises and ask for anything you want to know, and we're ready to provide that. The only thing we cannot provide to you is the identity of the people that we have you know, whose data, whose individual data, or the companies, you know, we gather. And my last point would be the fact that you only learn some things about official statistics and about the adherence of a national statistical system or a global statistical system to its principles under stress conditions. And this is something that I can, I mean, I don't want to use the word sell, but this is something I can somehow like benefit from. I can tell you that I come from the from a national statistical system that has been tested under stress conditions. You don't get to see what those principles of independence and of equal access and everything, you know, are about unless you're subject to stress conditions. And this actually proves your resilience and your reputation, you know, at the end of the day, which, as you can imagine, what I'm going to say, that this is something which is like it takes years to build, you know, but it takes only one, you know, a fraction of a second, you know, to tear down. It's my last slide. You know, I love this, like 22 out of 23. And I hope I have enough time, Professor Barberis. And I mean, this is how I view the output of my job. I think of it as an anchor. I think of it as a way of providing, you know, a stable point, a point of stability, a point of serenity around which policymakers, but also scientists can discuss. We don't do any comments about what is going on. What we do is just we give you the information and then you can analyze this and, you know, make us wiser. I mean, make everybody wiser. And this is what I see. And, you know, coming from Greece, you know, from Elstat, I mean, from an institution for which, you know, I'm very, very proud, I can tell you that going back to Greek statistics and the way we're in a process of rebranding Greek statistics and make it, you know, from a sign of ambivalence, of doubt, or even outright fraud, convert it to a sign of quality, credibility, resilience, of course, and consistency. Thank you very much.